माय पेशेंट 34 इयर्स ऑफ जेंटलमैन रविंदर गौर रेसिडिंग एट नासिक, फार्मर बाय ऑक्यूपेशन, एजुकेटेड टिल 12th स्टैंडर्ड एंड फ्रॉम लो सोशियो इकोनॉमिक स्टेटस, केम विद चीफ कंप्लेंट्स ऑफ ब्रेथलेसनेस ऑन एक्सर्शन सिंस 3 इयर्स एंड चेस्ट पेन सिंस 2 इयर्स, हिस्ट्री ऑफ प्रेजेंट इलनेस. पेशेंट वॉज अपेरेंटली ऑलराइट 3 इयर्स बैक व्हेन ही स्टार्टेड हैविंग ब्रेथलेसनेस. इंसिडेंट्स इन ऑनसेट ग्रेजुअली प्रोग्रेसिव इन नेचर सच दैट initially he started having breathlessness while walking up to his farm which is about 2 kilometers away from his home and on climbing 2 flights of the stair suggestive of the NYHA class 2 which has gradually progressed over last 3 years such that now since past 5 to 6 months he is having breathlessness even on the climbing 1 flight of the stairs and also on his activity like dressing undressing and taking bath his breathlessness used to get relieved by taking rest It was not associated with history suggestive of any orthopnea or PND. It was not associated with cough and seasonal variation. Patient also gives history of episodic chest pain, retrosternal, with heaviness sensation, at times constricting in nature, on exertion, not radiating anywhere, which used to last for around 4 to 5 minutes and relieved by taking rest since 2 years. The chest pain is gradually progressive in nature, such that
Just one episodic chest pain. Where it is? Episodic chest pain.
Retrosternal, sir.
Retrosternal,
constricting or heaviness, and sometimes constricting nature. The chest pain.
Typical angina.
Yes, sir. It suggests all 3 features of the typical angina is present, sir.
What is He's only 34 years man, right?
Yes, sir. He's only 34 years farmer.
34 farmers, typical angina, what is probability for him?
Yes, sir.
34 year man.
Huh?
History of a typical angina pectoris. So
yes,
what
sir?
Is the probability of a coronary atherosclerotic disease?
Sir, actually he is having a significant family history also. So, if paternal history is there, then CVD risk increases by 75% first degree male relative.
So, if you consider family history, means what? What is family history?
Sir, his father had similar complaints at his age of 45 years, and for which he was evaluated, and even diagnostic test was done, probably coronary angiogram, and. But a report is not available, but he was advised lifelong medication for it, and he was not advised any surgery.
Then it is not coronary, you know.
Yes,
mainly coronary. It is mainly coronary. So how do you, what is the meaning of family history coronary disease? Tell me, what do we mean
sir,
family history coronary disease?
Sir, if first degree relatives a male less than 55 years and female less than 65 years having symptomatic coronary artery disease, significant symptomatic coronary artery disease, then it is significant family history.
So this is a proven case of either patient has McLean impaction or patient has got coronary atherosclerosis proven by imaging, no?
Yes, sir.
Angiography by CT or by angiography.
Yes, sir. In this case, it is not that classical family history.
Yes. So okay. Forget that that your family history point. Just say what is the probability of coronary disease here? A 34 man having typical angina pectoris. High probability or intermediate probability, or it is low probability.
Low probability, sir.
Low probability or intermediate probability?
It depends on other history also, sir, like history of addictions or.
No. For history of angina pectoris, no? That diamond forest, no? They have done, no, they have this, they classified typical angina, non-ancestral pain, and.
Yes, sir. As for diamond forest, sir, it is typical angina only, sir. All 3 features are present.
No, tell me that. A patient has 34 year man has come to you. Typical angina pectoris. What will you do? What is your next plan?
Sir, there are scorings for like hard score for angina, sir, stable angina. You have to evaluate in patients of the chest pain, heart score. If score is 0 to 3, then we can consider it as a low risk, or 4 to 6, then medium risk. More than 7% high risk, sir.
No, that is what, see, that what patient comes to acute chest pain, no? That comes to acute chest pain, that is heart score, acute chest pain, comes to chest pain, you need, then you decide what to do. But patient has got, no, he has got a chronic history.
Yes,
chronic history of typical angina, 34 man, he's having like 3 years of chest pain like this. So what is the next case? Tell me, what to do next? What is the plan? What diagnosis will give and what will the plan, next plan? You know, there is no pharmaceutical coronary disease. Maybe he has got smoking or may not be smoking also. Not a diabetes or not hepatitis also. May not be there, but this is the only thing there. So what is the next step?
Next step, we'll do investigation, sir. We can do treadmill test or food echo.
Treadmill test. Why do you do treadmill test for what? Why do treadmill test? We are sitting in the clinics and a 34 or 35 man come and told, sir, I've got this. He will narrate the history and you thought it typical angina. What is the next step? You do an ECG.
Sir, first ECG 2D echo, followed by for a low probably CT coronary angiogram. Hello?
I'm hearing and thinking also. How will you answer your things? How will you respond to your answer? I'm thinking that. You do CT coronizing, what to do? What is the object of doing CT coronizing on you?
Low probability suspected CAD.
Low probability, nothing to do. So it is the intermediate probability of coronary disease. So anyway, so what to do next? You will do coronary. What is the object of doing echo?
To rule out whether it is coronary related ischemia or non-coronary causes of ischemia.
Tell me, what is non-coronary?
Non-coronary causes of angina or myocardial ischemia is like demand supply mismatch. For example, in aortic stenosis, sometimes nocturnal in aortic regurgitation, or cardiomyopathies like hypertrophic cardiomyopathies. This will be non-coronary ischemia because of demand supply mismatch.
Okay, so what are the other causes?
Tudico will rule out these causes, sir. And if these all obstructive diseases are not there, then we can think of CT coronary angiogram to rule out premature CAD.
So you can find it, okay, you can rule out atherosclerotic coronary disease, inflammatory coronary disease, anomalous congenital coronary disease, so rule out by CT. You have to mention like this. I do CT rule out the coronary ischemia because
anomaly,
inflammatory obstruction, and atherosclerotic, even though it is very less. But typical angina pectoris, in the absence of any structural heart disease, I would invest it in this line.
Okay,
fine. So what do you do then? Typical angina pectoris for the last 3 years, okay?
Angina is last 2 years, sir, gradually progressive. Now, currently in NYHA class 3.
How do functional class? How do what is the functional class of angina here?
Class 1. So, functional classification or NYHA classification and Canadian Cardiovascular Society classification, sir. In class 1, it's.
Now, what is the here functional class? I'm asking.
Here at present is a functional class 3, sir. Both dyspnea as well as exertional dyspnea as well as angina is class 3 at present. Progress over dyspnea progress over 3 years and angina progress over last 2 years.
Suppose a patient has a functional class 2 and now functional class 3, what is the pathophysiology? What is the pathophysiology so that you become more symptomatic? What could the pathophysiology?
Maybe a progression of the disease, sir, increasing more wall stress or increase in LVADP causing increase in pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, increasing functional class of the breathlessness.
No, no, I'm asking the angina, ma. I'm asking
angina. Sir, progression of the disease, like for example, in obstructive disease, if LVH progresses, wall stress will progress, and then LVDP will progress. Then as LVDP rise, coronary perfusion pressure will get impaired, and angina will increase.
So then what is the clinical implication of these things? Now class 2 become class 3. What do you think then? If a patient has progression of atherosclerosis or progression of any other factors, left atrial hypertrophy because hypertension or anemia, or what do you think over here?
Yes, sir. There can be precipitating factors, sir, like arrhythmia, anemia, associated systemic hypertension, precipitating in atherosclerosis, any plaque rupture, or...
How come anemia produces angina pectoris?
So anemia is increased demand, sir. Hypertime circulation in demand will increase. If patient is already compromised, then he will get decompensated. Decompensation will be there because of anemia.
No, I'm asking anemia is a cause of angina, or anemia is a factor for increase in severe angina. So how it is? You told both demand because hypertime circulation. Demand increase.
Both can be present, sir. Anemia can cause secondary angina also.
How can do that? I'm asking. What is the mechanism of secondary angina because of anemia?
Sir, demand supply mismatch, sir.
I'm not understanding it. Explain me. No, explain me how it affects demand side, how it affects supply side. Anemia, blood circulation increase, no? Because you to hypertime circulation, blood flow increase.
Yes, sir.
Then why do patients have angina pectoris? How is anemia can precipitate angina, or anemia is a factor for secondary angina? This is my question. Okay, oxygen carrying capacity also decreases, no? Because anemia lowers hemoglobin.
Yes, supply also will decrease.
More most important supply than demand. Hypertime circulation, how much like hypertime circulation? That is very negligible. It is supply side.
Yes, sir.
Supply side. Yeah. Okay, then go ahead then. So I will be asking like question like this because I will interrupt you and ask you. You will assess your knowledge, no? Last 3 years, how much knowledge gained in cardiology. So, yes.
Okay, sir. So this chest pain was gradually progressive in beginning at 2 years.
Type
2 MI is a same, sir. Demand supply mismatch, sir.
Yes, sir. Give some example of type 2 MI.
Hello, sir.
Give some examples of a type 2 MI. Example.
Sir, like sepsis, severe shock states, and embolisms.
Severe shock state means what? What is the adjective of severe shock state?
Sir, hypotension, sir. Severe hypotension or coronary artery spasms.
Yes,
severe anemia comes in the type 2 MI only, sir.
Very good. Then, so coronary spasm and...
whenever there is a mismatch, like demand supply mismatch. Arrhythmias.
Sepsis, how do the patient develop type 2 MI? Sepsis?
Refractory shock state... they can develop, sir.
Okay, let's tell them. Fine.
Okay. So this chest pain also was gradually progressive over the 2 years from NYHA class 2 to class 3. And now currently in the same activity level as that of the breathlessness. There is no history of palpitation, syncope or presyncope. No history of edema, feet, abnormal pain or reduced appetite, vomitings. No history of prolonged fever or skin lesion. No history of joint pain, joint swelling, or recurrence of throat in childhood. Because of the above complaints, patient has to stop his farming activities and was consulting to the local doctors. But because there was a failure of relief of symptom, came to the our hospital for evaluation and treatment. Past history is not significant. He's a non-hypertensive, non-diabetic. Personal history. Patient is married since 7 years with 2 children, well and healthy. Appetite is adequate.
Dr. Kanchan, I probably have not not had actually. Probably have missed. Have you told mentioned any syncope? No syncope?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. No history of palpitation, syncope, presyncopes.
Oh, sure. Fine.
Personal history, sir?
Yes.
Personal history, he is married since 7 years with 2 children, well and healthy. Appetite is adequate, mixed diet, bowel bladder normal, sleep normal. He is not having any addictions. Family history, sir. We already actually discussed family history. His father had a similar complaints at his age of the.
What are the addictions related to coronary disease? Or coronary events? What addictions are related to coronary?
Smoking, sir. Even cocaine can cause MI because of the coronary artery spasm. Alcohol to actually alcohol in a moderate limit. It is this is a protective. And
what higher limit?
Higher limit, it may cause alcoholic cardiomyopathy, sir. Dilated cardiomyopathy. Binge alcohol.
By alcohol can produce atherosclerosis?
No, not atherosclerosis, sir. It is protective moderate limit.
Why? No, moderate and high limit.
Not moderate limit.
High limit will not cause CADs.
Hello. High Hello. Limit. Alcohol in high limit.
Vascular
disease. Tell us what the release. Alcohol and cardiovascular disease. Just enumerate the.
Sir, holiday heart syndrome. Sir, alcohol. Binge alcohol can cause atrial fibrillations. Then dilated cardiomyopathies. Then cardiac cirrhosis. Alcohol.
Cardiac cirrhosis.
Means developed liver cirrhosis and followed by the congestive symptoms.
No, what? Alcohol hypertension, alcohol hypertension heart disease. Alcohol produces dyslipidemia. What is the dyslipidemia associated to alcohol? Alcohol, what is
high TG level, sir? High triglycerides level and
low HDL levels.
Any
naturally, if TG goes up and HDL goes down, so it has got any alcohol in high doses, high limit can produce atherosclerosis, can produce or not produce. Alcohol risk factor, no? Alcohol produce hypertension, alcohol produce dyslipidemia.
Chronic intake, sir, yes.
Any other addiction can in coronary artery disease or coronary events? You told cocaine, you told smoking, could be alcohol. Any drugs can?
Drugs can not like CAD, but infective endocarditis in drugs abuser, right sided infective endocarditis, it's a cardiovascular event.
5-fluorouracil.
What does it do? 5-fluorouracil to hypertension. 5-fluorouracil is it is what drug addiction?
No, sir, no, sir. Sorry.
Okay, fine. So let's go ahead then. So he has got no addiction then?
Yes, sir. Family history, sir. As we described earlier, his father had a similar complaints at about 45 years of his age, for which he was evaluated. Also, the diagnostic test was done through his right hand, probably coronary angiogram. Detailed reports they don't have, but he was found to have some heart disease at that time. And he was told that his father will require lifelong medication, and he was told to avoid strenuous activity lifelong. But there is no history of sudden cardiac death in the family.
What are the diseases will have sudden cardiac death in family? What are the diseases?
Sir, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is one of the diseases. Then anomalous coronary anomaly can cause sudden cardiac disease.
No, that runs in family.
No, sir. Channelopathy, sir.
No. Anomalous coronary disease runs in family or no? My question is, what are the diseases can cause family history? What are the coronary diseases we can suspect that you will have family history coronary disease? So one is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Yes, sir.
Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, very good. Then what else? Channelopathies.
Channelopathies are long QT syndromes, Guggenheim syndrome. Mm. These can cause sudden cardiac death.
Then what? Coronary disease?
ARV disease. Coronary disease with the left main involvement can cause sudden cardiac death, sir.
Why, yeah? Why left main? The left main involvement runs in family?
No, sir.
But then why do you mention those things? My question is...
Sorry, sir.
So coronary disease as a whole, any cardiomyopathy, no? All see, one third of cases, all like diabetic cardiomyopathy or familial cardiomyopathy. So any cardiomyopathy, familial cardiomyopathies.
Yes,
we have dilatory restrictive. Also, they can have familial cardiomyopathy. No? They can have a certain cardiac death in family.
ARVC. And not common, but mitral wall prolapse, sir. Very rarely they can have sudden
cardiac. Okay. Fine. So, no family history of sudden cardiac death.
Yes, sir.
Then?
History over, sir.
History, what do you think? So, essentially, the patient has the, he is a 34-year-old man. He has symptoms, symptomatic last 3 years, shortness of breath and typical angina. He is now functioning class 3.
Yes.
And no syncope, and family history of heart disease, but heart disease, and we don't know what the nature of heart disease. And he was advised to refrain from strenuous physical activities and be on medicine lifelong.
Yes.
So this is the only three important history, nothing else.
Yes,
sir. He has got no addiction, nothing. Not yes. A smoker, not a diabetic even also, not a hypertension, not a diabetic.
Yes,
sir. So this is, so basing on two history, the two important history, symptoms. So what is your diagnosis?
Sir, I would like to give differential diagnosis as first as a left ventricular outflow tract obstruction, either fixed in the form of congenital aortic stenosis or dynamic in the form of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So, thirdly, premature CAD is coronary artery disease is can be one of the differential diagnoses.
How to congenital aortic stenosis and second is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Yes, sir. LVT obstruction either fixed or dynamic, both are.
Both are possible.
Yes, sir.
If you take consideration into the family history, what do you think?
Family history, father having disease at the 45 years goes more in favor of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, dynamic obstruction, sir, or premature CAD.
Premature arthritis, you told that you be refrained from strenuous physical activity, be on lifelong medicine. Why lifelong medicine?
That's why I kept it as a second, sir. First will be dynamic alveolar obstruction in the form of cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Yes. So, what do you think that from the family history, you thought about why coronary disease patients remain lifelong on medicine and which condition, which case?
Sir, because he has not advised any stenting or surgery. One possibility is it can be recanalized vessels. Other possibility is diffuse triple vessel disease.
Yes. Diffuse disease. One is recanalized.
Non medical management, sir. So that's all.
But why did you refrain from the physical activities? Physical activities, why?
This is more goes in favor of the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, sir. Coronary artery, unless it is left main involvement or ostial significant critical lesions without any, then they can advise refrain from exertion, strenuous activity.
Could be congenital anomaly coronary disease, so that they could not
yes,
do
compression, coronary passing between aorta and PA section, possibly, okay. Sir.
Once you detect that patient is symptomatic, means immediate surgery, no?
Yes,
you can't you can't pull back the patient. You have to send for surgery.
Yes.
So that is not. So it's not a congenital anomaly.
Unlikely,
so disease. So from history, suggest it's a case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, not the coronary disease.
Yes. Sir.
Why? How come the strenuous physical activities is detrimental for this hypertrophic cardiomyopathy?
Sir, on exertion, there will be increase in heart rate. Increase in heart rate was increase in contractility, and it will increase the gradient across the wall. Then again, it will reduce the feeling. So preload, LV preload will reduce. That again increase the gradient. And if a patient is on not on medication like beta blocker to control heart rate, arrhythmia may precipitate. And which can lead to sudden
decompensation. Patient not on what? If not patient not on what? If
on beta blocker rate controlling drugs, then this can lead to sudden tachycardia, arrhythmia may get precipitated.
Beta blocker cannot prevent sudden kind of death. No, beta blocker cannot. No drugs can prevent. Even amiodarone cannot prevent a sudden kind of death in hypertrophic
cardiomyopathy.
So only that strenuous patient was. Advice against strenuous physical activity because of arrhythmia. Symptoms were there also, but because arrhythmia. Beta blocker, not amiodarone, no drugs can prevent sudden cardiac death in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so from history, we thought of the left atrial obstruction, most probably the case of dynamic obstruction,
hypertrophic.
Yes. Why dynamic obstruction? Why not is only hypertrophic cardiomyopathy per se? Why dynamic obstruction? Why obstruction is coming here? Why not it is a case of only hypertrophic cardiomyopathy?
Symptoms are mild, generally non-obstructive cardiomyopathy, sir. And he has progressed to class 3 symptom now. So, likely possibility of the obstructive variety.
Why there is symptoms is more marked in obstructive, not in non-obstructive cardiomyopathy. So it means hypertrophy anyway, same degree. Maybe non-obstructive cardiomyopathy, hypertrophy may be more also. So why it is why symptoms more in obstructive cardiomyopathy?
Systolic anterior motion with the mitral wall causing MR increasing PCWP, increasing the symptoms, sir. That is more commonly with the obstructive variety.
So because MR you mean? MR the cause for the symptoms?
Combined cause, sir. There are multifactorial mechanisms.
No, tell one or two factors, tell you.
Sir,
one is MR.
For breathlessness, sir. Anjan.
Symptoms, no? What it was? You told that because symptoms is rapid, it is progressive disease, progressive symptoms, progressive. So I'm thinking obstructive rather than non-obstructive. And non-obstructive symptoms not much like this. So why the obstructive cardiomyopathy patients are more symptomatic? And what is the mechanism?
Sir, because of obstruction, the wall stress, LV wall stress is increased more in this variety. So increased wall stress will cause more hypertrophy. So there will be more demand. Also, this hypertrophy will can lead to bridging of the intramural vessels, or this will lead to increase LVDP more. So increase LVDP more will cause more increase in PCWP.
Cardiomyopathy because of LV left hypertrophy because of LV obstruction. Hypertrophy cardiomyopathy hypertrophy because of LV obstruction or hypertrophy because of LV obstruction.
No, sir. Actually, there is micromyocyte disarray, and this is that causes.
Disarray occur in both hypertrophic and obstructive non-obstructive also. There's no much difference in disarray in obstructive versus non-obstructive. You understand my point? No, understood.
Yes, sir. Understood, sir.
Then okay. So you when you guys are reading, no, when you are studying the subject, no, you study in this way. Study, you analyze and study. So that you can remember pathophysiology mechanisms. Why the obstructive variety, the symptoms are more. Even though overall cardiac death is more in obstructive than obstructive.
Yes, sir.
More symptoms, more articulations in obstructive varieties because of obstruction there. Obstruction one is to even told increase in intramural pressure. Increase MR will more, obviously. LA pressure more means your left ventricle LA gradient more, so MR will more. MR will augmented. So pulmonary yes. Patient will have significant pulmonary venous hypertension one. Cardiac yes. Output is less. Reduce cardiac output. Cardiac output yes. Decrease. That is producing syncope, pyncope, all everything.
Yes,
that further increase coronary ischemia. More fibrosis.
Yes,
more fibrosis. More diastolic dysfunction. No, yes. More diastolic dysfunction. So this is perpetuate. So
yes.
Fine. So it could be so because of progression of disease. You thought of rather than of cardiomyopathy. And second possible, probably it is a case of may not be. It could be a second angle seizure. Bulbar aortic stenosis.
Yes.
The only thing that patient has bulbar aortic or more than almost 3 years now symptoms, and keeping in mind the family step. Okay, bicuspid aortic valve runs in family.
Yes.
But why the patient of bicuspid valve told that you need not require surgery, be a lifelong treatment now. So if considered history, not a bicuspid aortic valve, it is a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, obstructive variety.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So could you take a case of dilated cardiomyopathy? Because patient has no syncope. So why not take a dilated cardiomyopathy?
Sir, in chest pain is not common in dilated cardiomyopathy. That goes in.
Who told you? There, no. Chest pain also there because dilated cardiomyopathy is a condition where there is microvascular dysfunction there. So patient develop typical angina pectoris. And you not in that, you may get also regional wall motion abnormalities on echo also any dilated cardiomyopathy. You may get why not dilated cardiomyopathy? Or do you have to get dilated cardiomyopathy in family? Probably the father had dilated cardiomyopathy at certain day. Not certain day. You have told me on medicine diagram, no surgery for dilated cardiomyopathy.
Yes, sir.
It could be low rank. It is probability is less than the study one apple cardiomyopathy, but still you can think of. So this is Michael disease and mostly not a valvular disease, Michael disease. And coronary because typical angina pectoris, shortness of breath, and no other risk factors. So the intermediate possibility, intra-proverted coronary disease is not hyperproverted coronary disease, even though there is patient had typical angina pectoris. As per the age and gender is concerned, we would think of intermediate proverted coronary disease. And
yes,
with that, but obviously there are no risk factors for that for the patient. Or patients will have a animal's coronary disease. We have give three, four times and you discuss one by one, we discuss like this.
Yes.
Okay. On examination.
Patient is conscious, cooperative, oriented to time place person, moderately big, moderately nourished with a BMI of 22.8. Upper limb and lower limb ratio is 1.0, back, spine normal, no dysmorphic features, no pallor, cyanosis, clubbing, edema, icterus. Temperature is normal by palpation. Pulse is 84 per minute, regular, normal volume, with a brisk upstroke, without any radioradial or radiofemoral delay, with a normal condition of the arterial wall, all peripheral pulses palpable. Blood pressure is 110 by 17 right upper limb, 112 by 70 millimeters mercury left upper limb, 120 mmHg systolic in the palatal lower. Respiratory rate is 18 per minute, regular, abdominal thoracic. JVP is 3 cm above sternal angle in 45 degree proctor position with a prominent A wave with a normal distance, with a normal respiratory variation, with a negative abdominal jugular reflex. Carotid says no thrill. Cardiovascular examination, sir. Inspection palpation combined. Chest is bielectrically symmetrical, normal electrical in shape. Trachea central. Apex plate is palpable in the left 5th intercostal space, medial to the midclavicular line, heaving in nature with a medial retraction, LV type of apex without any thrill. There in a left 3rd parasternal lesion, there is a systolic thrill present. S4 is palpable. There is no parasternal heave.
There is no parasternal? There is no?
No parasternal heave.
Okay.
Percussion, sir. Left heart border corresponds to apex. Right heart border is retrosternal. Left second intercostal space is resonant. Liver dynamics present in the right fifth intercostal space in midclavicular line. On auscultation, S1 is normal. S2 is paradoxical split. S4 is audible with the bell of the stethoscope in at apex in the left lateral position. There is no SC, no click. There is a harsh ejection systolic murmur of grade 4 by 6 intensity. Crescendo, picosimple in nature. Late picking, breast heard in the left 3rd intercostal space, not radiating to the carotid. Better heard in inspiration, standing, and with a strained phase of the Valsalva. Reduced in intensity on squatting, supine position, and with isometric hand grip. There are two murmurs, sir.
Isometric hand grip is reducing intensity.
Yes, sir.
Isometric hand grip is reducing intensity. Okay. Isometric hand grip. Okay. Fine, correct. Go ahead.
Grade 3 by 6 high pitched blowing parasystolic murmur, best heard at the apex, radiating to axilla, heard with the diaphragm stethoscope, increase on standing and reducing on the squatting. Other system examination are within normal limits, sir.
Actually, Manu, going to axilla, what is happening? What is happening? What is dynamic auscultation? What happened? Ancestral murmur going to axilla, grade
3 by 6, sir, no thrill.
Yes.
Increases on standing, sir, decreases on squatting. And yes,
Yes. My. That's all.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
And then?
Only 2 problems, sir.
Is there lungs?
Lungs, sir.
No, lungs, pumps, nothing there.
Other system exertions within normal limits, sir. Diagnosis.
Yes.
It is a severe dynamic LV outflow tract obstruction in the form of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy with a moderate MR without significant pulmonary artery hypertension with diastolic dysfunction currently in NYHA class 3 in sinus
without,
rhythm.
Without significant
pulmonary artery hypertension.
Almost pulmonary hypertension.
Sir, here he is NYHA class 3.
Yes,
so they suggested the moderate PVS, sir, around 18 to 24. So mean pulmonary artery pressure will be around 12 plus, if you consider 20 mean, then it will be mean pulmonary artery pressure will be around 12 plus 20, 32, sir. So
mild
pH. Mild pH, but clinically
they are not able to appreciate.
Yes, sir.
Okay, melodial operation. Fine, then. So, moderate MR, severe LVP diameter obstruction, moderate MR. This MR is dynamic or it is fixed also?
What, sir?
The MR is dynamic. You told severe LVP dynamic obstruction. And
yes,
moderate
sir.
MR, dynamic MR or is fixed MR?
Sir, here it looks like a fixed dynamic MR, sir. But two-third patient may have, along with dynamic MR, they may have
hey, what is your name? Kalpana, I'm not asking the theory. It is practical exam asking. I'm practically here, practical theory, not here. It is dynamic MR? Or
dynamic
MR. Dynamic moderate MR.
Yes, sir.
So dynamic moderate MR, then moderate PBH and mild pH by hemodynamic assessment. Then
in sinus rhythm.
Yes, them. Then
currently in NYHA class 3.
Class 3. Then no endocarditis.
No, sir. No, without any features of any.
Okay, let us go one by one. So, why do you say severe dynamic LVP obstruction? So, etiology what? Severe dynamic obstruction. What is etiology of dynamic obstruction?
Hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, sir.
Any other condition you get dynamic LVP obstruction? Forget this case. Any other conditions you get dynamic LVP obstruction? Dynamic LVP obstruction.
No, sir.
No. Don't know. Oh, read then. Dynamic, all of you, read dynamic LVP obstruction, excepting your cardiomyopathy, aortic cardiomyopathy.
Okay, sir.
Read all of you. This is given task to you all. Of. So, what do you mean dynamic MR? Tell me what are the conditions with dynamic MR?
No,
I'm not asking here. I'm asking tell me conditions to get MR. Now, little theory now.
Okay. Dynamic MR, whenever there is a systolic anterior motion of the mitral left because of reduced coaptation, like in hypercontractile state, hypercontractile state, sir, LVS, sir. Then infiltration of the septum.
Dr. Kanchan, I'm not asking why do you get dynamic MR here. I'm asking what? Tell me the conditions where you get dynamic MR. Some theoretical aspect I'm discussing. Conditions where you get dynamic MR. One is hepatic cardiomyopathy. Second.
MR, sir, acute myocardial infarction.
Tell ischemic MR, tell no why to acute myocardial
infarction.
Ischemic MR. Inferior wall. Oh, ischemic MR, tell forget the inferior MI, anterior MI. Ischemic MR. Then, any other condition to dynamic MR? Bhushan?
Sir, mitral wall prolapse, sir.
Good, mitral prolapse. So that's your answer. That's the second answer, I think.
Yes.
The second answer. So obstetric cardiomyopathy, or otherwise the first diagnosis should be first answer should be mitral prolapse, ischemic MR, aortic cardiomyopathy, and atrial fibrillation. Atrial fibrillation beat to beat variation, dynamic MR. Okay.
Yes.
Will you dysfunction dynamic MR again or not? MR because LV dysfunction. Yeah, dynamic MR LV improves.
Yes, sir. In acute LVF, we can severity of MR may be more.
So you are doing all the mistakes, man. Your guys are doing it. How are you measuring acute LVF here? See, your mistakes are no. Your acute ischemic MR, acute macular infarction MR. No. Acute LVF dynamic. LVF dynamic MR get LV dysfunction. LV dysfunction tell you why you say LVF. Okay, so which control is 6 MR?
6 MR, rheumatic MR, sir.
Rheumatic MR, MR due to metal analog calcification because metal ring, your effect or pacifier doesn't constitute, doesn't expand because of the calcification of metal ring, metal annulus.
Yes.
Mitral stenosis, you can get fixed or mitral stenosis, fixed MR.
Yes.
Okay, so why do you get severe? Let's come to what is that topic now? Why do you say severe dynamic value test person? What is the meaning of severe here? Has it got any meaning? See, severe aortic stenosis, you know that patient severe aortic needs surgery.
Yes, sir.
Understand? Mm-hmm. So severe LVOT dynamic obstruction heart. What does it mean? What is the natural history severe? Severe versus moderate. Patient has got 100 gradient LVOT, and one person and a few person has got 45 to 50 gradient. So any 50 gradient or 60 gradient. Okay, 60, 70 gradient. Other people 120 gradient. Any difference in your natural history? Difference in your symptoms? I'm discussing very critically. I'm discussing, so you have to read in that way, prepare the case that way. If supposing a long case, no, I would like, yes, to ask this like this. See, severe, when you say severe aortic stenosis, it has got some implication. Patient need to undergo surgery, or patient should be evaluated for surgery, even though patient not symptomatic. So here, you told severe. You mentioned that severe. Dynamic elevated obstruction. So what is this clinical implication? Does it require, because the severity of gradient does require any risk factor for patient has 50 gradient, or somebody has 120 gradient. 120 gradient is more prone to develop sudden cardiac death, or more prone to develop all complications of aortic cardiomyopathy? Tell me that.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, it is mentioned as potential arbitrator for the sudden cardiac death, sir. Resting gradient of more than 50. Resting gradient of more than 50 is, sir, arbitrary.
I know, my dear. He told severe. What is the definition of severe LVOT dynamic obstruction? What is the meaning of severe LVOT dynamic obstruction? When this is more than 40 meters per second, your velocity. No, so mean plane, no, or more than mean gradient more than 40 meter mercury. So what is the here? How to qualify a patient has got severe LVOT dynamic obstruction?
Mm-hmm.
You see, Dr. Kanchan, don't feel bad. You're till now very good. Your presentation is good. Your diagnosis is come. But I'm asking you, how do you mean severe?
Actually, because clinical there was thrill, paradoxical speak, and late picking murmur. That's why. Actually, no.
Correct, that is, you are correct. But what is the clinical meaning? See, you understand? Severe MR,
yes,
patient
sir.
Required surgery. Simply severe aortic, severe LV dynamic
obstruction. Yes, sir. Symptomatic hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy is greater than more than 50. If drug refractory, it is indication for intervention.
So what is the meaning of severe here, I'm asking? I understand, but no, when severe aortic stenosis means the velocity more than 4 meter per second, gradient is more than 40 meter per second. So what do you mean severe here?
There is no such definition.
No such thing. No such thing. So minimum peak gradient more than 40 meter marker here or not?
Yes.
Why do you say 50 meter marker? That is your no. That is cut off for the intervention.
Yes.
Either rest or provocative.
Yes.
So I am getting a thing, sir. If you are, I don't know. Somebody has to verify your findings. How often you get a paragraph split in the obstetric cardiomyopathy? That is theoretical, but how often clinically you get your paragraph split in obstetric cardiomyopathy? One has to check your findings. So that means you are telling, sir, this patient is drug refractory because I'm telling severity definitely more than because I'm getting 3 part of the speed.
Late picking murmur.
Why should pay late pick murmur? You know, start late, no. Murmur will start late, always late. Mid-late system. So, but picking late, fine. Picking late, starting mid-systole, going to later part of the systole. So it is delayed here. You got Esper because what, yeah?
Esper is because of left atrial contractions and because of the LV stiff, there's a forceful left contraction.
Has it got any meaning in case aortic stenosis?
In aortic stenosis, it represents severity, but HCM, it does not represent severity. It is Esper, palpate in both obstructive as well as non-obstructive.
Okay, fine.
It does not mean any severity.
Okay. So yeah, S4 has got no relation severity of the obstruction, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes. So then, okay, fine. So next,
moderate MR to. Oh,
yes,
Shweta Kone.
Yes. Moderate, why do you say moderate MR?
Sir, because clinically mild MR is difficult to diagnose, and there is no feature suggestive of the severe MR. Like there is no SD, there is no associated mid-diastric murmur, or no LV dilatation. So I'm thinking of moderate MR.
But you got a pancitic murmur, no? How can you get a pancitic murmur here? Murmur start because if you think MR is, you told MR dynamic MR, told, no?
Yes.
Then you told a pancitic murmur. So not a pancitic murmur, mid to late system.
Mid to late.
So mid to late system cannot be severe, is it? Usually won't be severe, usually. Because regression time is less.
Yes.
About systole. And murmur having pansystolic murmur, definitely is MR severe than the murmur having only half of the systole.
Yes.
Hey, regurgitation throughout the diastole and regurgitation only half of the systole. So definitely it is murmur, MR not severe here, obviously.
Yes.
And why are you going to axilla?
Because of posterior effect, maybe because whenever there is a dynamic MR associated with the SAM, there is a funnel form which projects the jet to the posterior.
Okay. If it's coming, okay, fine. Then you told what functional class 3. No endocarditis. If endocarditis occurs, where local, what site of endocarditis?
Site of endocarditis will be at the point where AML is hitting the IBS and the ml pip.
Aortic valve.
Not aortic valve, sir. Anterior mitral leaflet where it is hitting the IVS. That contact point also can get affected, but very rarely. In fact, undercut is not common in arthroscopic cardiomyopathy.
Okay, what is the, then what the, how to, what the plan for this case?
Sir, there are two, three things we have to do, sir. First is risk stratification for sudden cardiac death and patient's education. Second point will be the medical management, initiating the beta blocker to keep heart rate at rest around 55 to 60 and exercise less than around 80. And if it continues the symptom, we can add non-hydrocarbine calcium channel blocker, such as verapamil or diltiazem.
We'll add, sir.
If his symptoms are not improving with the beta blocker. And third line of medical treatment is
rasopar. What are the contraindications of verapamil?
Sir, if patient is very severe hypotension or there is a significantly raise PCWP, then we should not add verapamil.
No, that means you have to do one case study before adding verapamil or what? You told you know, CW, capital waist pressure. No, how do you know capital waist pressure?
So symptoms, sir, if class 4 symptoms.
Symptoms because of the diastolic dysfunction, no? That symptom. Because of symptoms, they are giving no drugs. My question is contraindication of verapamil. You told the patient has got severe symptoms and capillary osteoporosis. How do you know capillary osteoporosis? You need to catch study this case. Can you derive LA pressure? LA pressure in echo, LA pressure. Assessment by LA pressure in echocardiograph in this case.
Sir, E by E dash, sir. More than 10.
Okay, E by E prime.
E by E prime. Yes, sir.
Then?
Then, a disopyramid is difficult. Availability is
any other method to know LA pressure. One E by E prime, that is, it will give not exactly value, won't give. That will give arbitrary. Is more than this, than this. Arbitrary will give the LA pressure, AOH pressure. Any other method to know LA pressure here? Are you got MR, no? MR, you can systolic pressure, MR gradient minus kardo. LV systolic pressure minus MR gradient.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. But that not also correct because of what? Jet may not be because it pushes through jet. May not be
difficult
jet.
To assess.
So my question is how to assess severe to MR in the presence of hepatic osteocardiomyopathy. Echocardiographically. Same. Apply or anything there you know anyway you can't jet width on a jet length you cannot apply here because jet length is depend on LB gradient between LB and LA here is disproportional high LB to LA gradient. Tell me how to assess severe to MR in the presence of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Don't know, read these things, all of you read please.
Yes.
Okay, only gradient more than 100 meter mercury LVOT gradient, verapamil should not give because verapamil produces pulmonary edema.
Okay. Yes, sir.
And yes. Whenever any calcium blocker given, very very carefully give because patient may develop pulmonary edema.
Yes.
So you can give some beta blocker, you can escalate a dose can increase. So till patient develops significant bradycardia or symptoms of beta blocker. Then you can add to that disopyramide maybe. If it's available, disopyramide not available nowadays.
Yes.
So more than that, more the starting treatment, you have to assess the risk factor for sudden cardiac death. Or E only 30.
Yes, sir. We have to assess his children also. We have to ask, tell him to watch when they are more than 12 years of age. They have to do echo screening for children also. And yes, his self risk stratification also we have to do for certain cardiac.
Yeah, self.
His risk stratification also we have to do for sudden cardiac death, as well as his fields also we have to ask, tell him to monitor in future.
What future? Might?
Whenever his kids will be more than 12 years of age, then we have to screen, echo screening we have to do.
Family screening, okay, fine.
Family screening, fine,
very good. So family screening will do, and a screening for a sudden cardiac death. So two things are done. Yeah. So anyway, for screening, the clinical or clinically cannot do full assessment for sudden cardiac risk. You have to take the help of
echo,
CMR. How CMR help you?
Sir, in CMR, if diffuse late gadolinium enhancement is extensive, more than 20%. Then even if absent,
20% told you, cut off 15%.
Please, I mean for significance, even if absence of other risk factors, it is a significant risk for sudden cardiac.
Then, MRI one is more than 15% of the your gadolinium
enhancement, which suggests fibrosis.
Then what are the else? No, MRI science, MRI imaging science for high risk. One is gadolinium enhancement. Second, what is the role of MR?
Fibrosis is caring. We can quantify MR also, sir. Volumes we can measure better.
That not help us, no. MR, I just asked.
Not for sudden cardiac.
Radical HTM we can diagnose, sir. And thickness of the wall, if it is more than 3 centimeters, is a risk factor.
Yes, MRI can give thickness of wall. So, atypical location, when you can't profile in echocardiography, especially yes, posterior vessel and apical. So, can't profile by echocardiographically. So, MR will help in diagnosis. So, MR is very useful tool for diagnosis as well as prognosis.
Even sir, RV involvement, we can look better in.
For me, that is imaging. No, that whenever echo cannot help us, MRI can help. So yes, that diagnosis and prognosis.
Yes.
And most important thing is that your assessment for a high risk, that gadol enhancement and apical aneurysm. Apical aneurysm, one of the substrate. No, that is for the one of the substrates for high risk.
Yes.
Apical aneurysm. Mm-hmm. And what else? And matlab anatomy is very crucial for especially for surgery or matlab dysfunction in HCM, which you can't image in echocardiography, that MRI will give the correct picture. There are several types of matlab anomalies, no, matlab leaflet positions.
Anterior displacement of
papillary muscles. Papillary muscle position, metal leaflet length, metal apparatus anatomy, which can't amaze by photography, that MRI give the clear picture. So that is important for the surgeons. And probably more upcoming now, they see the LA assessment. No, diagnosis, but that diagnosis I'm telling. Diagnosis means diagnosis and different diagnosis. You have to see, you have to exclude the SA mimics, Noonan syndrome, the infiltrated disorders.
Yes, sir.
Something like your, even if sometimes your abdomyoma or sometimes mistaken as your hepatocardiomyopathy, especially children. So that will help, MRI will help you in diagnosis and different diagnosis, excluding the.
That's
it,
sir. We can differentiate.
Yeah, SA mimics. Yes. Then prognosis, important. And metal apparatus anomalies, metal apparatus anatomy. And now you can see the LA function and LA, you know, LA imaging for the any fibrosis, which is predictor of atrophiliation. Atrophiliation is horrible. One of the most dangerous natural history of hepatocardiomyopathy.
Yes.
More symptomatic because there to beat to beat variation of the your LA left ventricle stroke output and so beat to beat variation of left ventricle output obstruction because of the small volume, big volume, smaller volume, bigger volume of left ventricle cavity. Because there is difference, there is varying in preload and afterload in atrophiliation. So atrophiliation is very dangerous. One of the atrophiliation more symptomatic because their atrial boost is lost.
Gone. Yes.
And second thing is it is a high risk group for developing heart failure and stroke also.
Yes.
CHADNA score is not required in
SM. Yes.
Anticoagulation. So then they'll ask the third question. They'll ask, you know, they have to restratify, you know, they'll restratify. Either any, they ask the question, common question, one risk versus multiple risks. I'm telling this, you read this thing, and they'll ask you, supposing you to primary, for primary prevention, you put the ICD, so what the discharge rate annually? Secondary prevention, the discharge rate annually. So they'll ask, what is inappropriate shock, ICD shock in hepatocardiomyopathy? What could the cause for this inappropriate shock in hepatocardiomyopathy? So then the role of intervention, that indication intervention, septal ablation by surgery versus alcohol, difference.
Yes.
Alcohol ablation versus surgery. And what are the suitable cases for surgery? All cases suitable cases. No, first case where the septal thickness more than 18 millimeter IBS. Yes. And, somebody did 14 millimeter also, so we write 18 millimeter is good.
Cut up, yeah.
So what the difference outcome of septal ablation versus surgical ablation? And what is your preference?
Questions.
So there is a need to do ICD implant after septal ablation. And UPS then justify any study for you to mention. So what to do for this case? For this case, I'll assess for the high risk categories, risk stratification for ICD. If not there, only put on medicine and patient is still on symptoms.
Refractory, then myomectomy, because he's young patient, no much comorbidities, myomectomy would be best option.
And you'll do echo or MRI assessment, see the metal apparatus, does it require any additional metal or surgery or not?
Repair, yes sir.
Yes. Okay. Good. Very good. Does there any role in genotyping here?
Sir, few mutations they are more malignant, in that risk of the sudden cardiac death will be more like trochoma is seen and motions
But guideline doesn't say go for genotyping. But what is the role of genotyping in clinical practice? Is there a role of genotyping in clinical practice?
If there is a malignant family history of sudden cardiac death, then we may discuss. Because these are mutations like trochoma is in, they will have only mild hypertrophy, but they will have more sudden cardiac death risk will be very high. So if there is a malignant history of the family history of sudden cardiac death in patient, then mild hypertrophy in echo, then better to go for genotyping to evaluate risk of sudden cardiac death.
Genopositive and phenonegative, what will get in echo? I ask this question.
Gene positive
but phenonegative. What echo can get?
There won't be much hypertrophy, sir, in our
But what you get, something will get, no?
You
will get LV diastolic dysfunction, you will get some blood clots in the myocardium, blood clots myocardium, and also elongation of the myocardial plates.
Okay.
You will get. And patient has genopositive and phenonegative by his 25 years. Then what is
okay.
your plan for genopositive or phenonegative? We are following out of 2 years following, no? every two or five years following.
Sir, from
listen, all of you listen. So let me finish my questions. Genopositive family history of the patient has got no the proband. Patient has got and his family history, brothers, sisters. So one brother he has got genopositive but phenonegative by 12 years. Then what to do? By 12 years, genopositive and phenonegative. Then what to do next?
Yearly, annually echo screening till 18 years of the age and more than 18, 5 yearly echo screening. Okay.
Till death? Continue like this.
Generally, they will develop in adolescence only, sir.
Yeah, up to 18 years, you told, no, 12, up to 12 years, guys, usually they get 12 years. Now, it will 18 years, fine. Then 18 years, after every 5 years, 23 years, phenonegative. 28 years, phenonegative. Every 5 years, you do, no, then. So how many, how frequent will do and how long will do this? They have told that in 60, 70 years also the patient can manifest there is a phenotypical expression of disease even late 50, 60 years.
The 5 year leak.
Huh? So
five
every 5 year
leak.
I don't know. I'm asking you, might I read these things? Anybody know this answer or read it and let me know that I don't. I want to know this answer.
Okay, sir. I'll read, sir.
Certainly, you read. Okay, so what is the role of Holter here? Yeah? You told somebody Holter.
Oh,
what is the role of Holter?
Yes, sir. NSVT, if we find on Holter monitoring, then it is a conventional risk marker for. Sir, cardiac cancer. For
restratification,
it is indicated.
NSVT only one. We did 48 hours Holter and only one episode NSVT.
So one episode is not sir, but multiple and repetitive non-sustained VTs are risk factors.
Tell me, no, only one. Only 40 Holter you can keep for how many days? Any time for years, to months together, no, weeks together. So 48 hours, okay, maximum 72 hours to Holter. Okay, 7 days. 7 days you fixed Holter. Only one or two episodes of their NSVT. Then what to do? There are no other risk factors. There are no other risk factor for cardiac death. Only this one. Because you didn't get anything, just fixed Holter. So Holter you got only 48 hours or 72 hours. One morning, one afternoon. There are two episodes there. So really very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Very difficult to judge. Really, it is, everybody expresses the same thing in literature. It's very difficult to, unless the patient, the most important, the most class one indication is aborted short cardiac death. Or patient has short cardiac death, that is most class one indication. Class one indication level of evidence is to implanting ICD in hypercardiomyopathy. Next, maybe
yes.
Patient has got, there is sustained VT, more than 30
yes.
minutes, 30 seconds VT.
Or unexplained recent syncopes or family history.
Unexplained means what? Unexplained means patient there is no history, no suggestive vasovagal attack, not drug induced syncope. Anybody comes with syncope, not indication for implanting pacemaker, implanting ICD in case of hypercardiomyopathy. You have to rule
yes.
out the causes of there are no definite cause of syncope.
Yes.
Patient don't understanding is maturating APL. In not indication for ICD.
Yes, sir. And explain recent within last 6 months, sir.
So very really very difficult unless there is strong family history or aborted sudden cardiac death or recurrent VT you have documented. Otherwise very difficult to have, you know, to a decision to implant pacemaker, implant ICD.
So there's score also, sir. ICD score.
Not validated. Don't mention score. That is European Society. They are not validated. And this American tool, they don't accept that. See, latest guideline, no, latest, there is no, there is still not that score, they're not asking, and they're accepting that. European Society, they're not validated.
Okay.
That again, so many things, early dimensions are taken, after failures, no, elevator after, so many things they have taken.
Yes, sir.
So, in a good case discussion, they will ask like these questions. You should know that is no arbitrator, etc. Brown had given one whole page, no table. So read that thing, remember that.
Okay.
Moreover, they'll ask more about the clinical part. Clinical part, why do you get paragonal split? What is S4? Why do you get S4? What is triple ripple? What is a double apical impulse? What can control double apical impulse?
Yes.
So ask the clinical oriented question, then you go to theory. Okay, what kind of ICD will put? Dual chamber, single chamber?
Dual chamber.
Why not single chamber? So these patients are prone to develop supraventricular arrhythmia because of the LA dilatation.
Yes, sir. 20-25%. Yes.
It is better to put dual chamber ICD.
Yes.
Okay. Understand?
Yes, sir. Paroxysmal AF.
Some patient, no. See, we had a patient actually. In fact, what happened? He has got Bhushan and our Krishnadas might be knowing this. So patient is hepatic cardiomyopathy and he has got syncope. And syncope, that means history suggests cardiac syncope. You are sitting and you had got loss of consciousness. Just on walking a little fast, I got unconscious twice. So he came to us. Then he got it. There is a complete heart block actually. We saw intermittent complete heart block. So what is the plan for this case? I have to do obstructive cardiomyopathy, syncope, and we could able to find out person has got intermittent complete heart block. So what is your plan for this case?
We have to put dual chamber ICD.
Dual chamber, single chamber, or his model.
Dual chamber.
Swell, what put swell is there? That swell. Swell there, swell is not there. Swell? Hello.
Dual chamber.
No, I'll put ICD, dual chamber ICD.
Dual chamber ICD, I mean. So dual chamber ICD.
Dual ICD. Not as a pacemaker. Dual ICD. Anyway, the patient has got hepatic cardiomyopathy per se. There is a substitute for ventricular arrhythmia. So,
yes, dual chamber.
Okay, then patient has got, what is the indication of ICD? In hepatic cardiomyopathy, one is, and also the risk factor also, no, there one for risk also, there is LV dilatation, end-stage heart failure also. No,
yes,
based on end-stage heart failure, that is also a risk for heart.
Yes, sir, that is a potential risk. Yes,
sir. Yes, so then that is also indication for.
The primary indication will be documented cardiac arrest or documented VTs or hemodynamically significant VTs. That will be class 1 indications.
Yeah, that is classical level, that is no doubt. There is no doubt about starting a death or BTP there, your document BT, no doubt that. No, these are things. And a patient has gone to end stage heart failure, that is also if you rejection person less than 35 and
class 2
indication for ICD. And of course, if it's QRS prolonged, then CRDD you can implant.
Yes.
Yes. So then, what are the predictors of end-stage heart failure? Less than 5%, 3-5% of patient goes to heart failure.
Yes.
So what are the predictor of end-stage heart failure? Only family history, nothing else. And previously told that patient has got obstetric cardiomyopathy goes to venous heart failure. No, only family history of venous heart failure. That is the only predictor of venous heart failure.
Okay.
So what will happen patient obstetric cardiomyopathy and they will ask the question. Patient obstetric cardiomyopathy and after some time you saw there is no obstruction, aortic obstruction. So you can think of it dynamic. Sometimes you may get meningitis, second stage patient gone to interstitial heart failure, won't have LVOT obstruction because interstitial heart failure, LVOT dilate, no. LVOT dilate, so LVOT narrowing won't occur.
Yes.
So no more patient will have LVOT obstruction.
Yes, sir.
Of course, after the Morris surgery or after the septal ablation, obstruction will disappear.
Yes.
These are the causes of absence of obstruction in the natural history of the disease. Okay, so like this, so depends how much they know in case of the other septal ablation, they can ask a theory. Which area will ablate, what the purpose of ablating the things, and how much alcohol you take, how to identify the area, which septal artery to inject, they may ask you if it's a long case given.
Yes, sir.
If a long case is given to, they'll ask you. If short case, there's no much time, so they'll ask not many questions.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so they'll ask you what is disarray. What is disarray? How to diagnose disarray?
Myocyte disarray, sir. Sir, yes, sir. In pathology, there will be wall appearance, sir. They will lose the normal architecture. And world appearance will be there and histopathology. Biopsy.
What is the macro anatomy, macroanatomical pathology of aortic cardiomyopathy obstacle?
Sir, there is a loss of architecture, myocyte disarray. Then there is reduced capillary.
Not macroscopic, macroscopic, macro.
Sarcomere mutation, sir.
Okay. Macro, not micro.
Macro. Okay, sir.
Macro. Yes, macro. Tell me. So, left ventricular hypertrophy, LV cavity small, LA enlargement there.
Yes,
no,
sir.
They think.
Yes, sir.
And there is septal, contact septal, AML septal contact, the thickening, glistening appearance. You talk like this.
Yes.
Yes. And they will ask you the athlete hearts versus.
Yes, sir. Athlete hearts, they will rarely go beyond 16 mm LV cavity. Endospheric cavity will be more than 55. Then on deconditioning, there will be reversible of the fibrosis. And on CMR, there will be no or minimal fibrosis in athlete's heart.
Echo, there are no diastolic dysfunction.
Yes, there are no diastolic dysfunction. And the cavity will be larger. LV end-diastolic volume will be more than 55. And
LA enlargement more in which condition? LA enlargement. LA enlargement, yeah.
HCM.
Yes. Okay, so fine. Okay, staff, you are good. Your presentation good and case also good. Discussion also went on well.